Today we are going to begin our study on nuclear chemistry. Let's first look at the topics we'll be discussing. We're going to do a quick review of energy relationships. We're going to discuss radioactivity and nuclear stability. We're going to learn how to write nuclear equations and calculate half-life, as well as discuss fission, fusion, some medical applications, and how radiation is measured. Let's begin with a quick review of energy and the relationships that exist. Frequency is defined as the number of times a wave passes over the origin. Wavelength is the distance between two crests or troughs of a wave. This is an example of a wave. The crest is here, and the trough is here. This is another crest, so from here to here would be the wavelength of the wave. Energy and frequency are two concepts that are related to one another. As energy increases, so does frequency. So when E goes up, frequency goes up. That's the funny symbol for frequency. So it is a direct relationship. Energy and wavelength instead are opposites or inverses. So as energy goes up, wavelength, which is represented with a lambda, decreases. So they have an inverse relationship. Here on the bottom of the screen, you can see both a high and a low frequency wave. High frequency waves are high energy. Low frequency waves are low energy. Let's go ahead and define radioactivity. Radioactivity is defined as the process by which atoms spontaneously emit energy or rays from the nucleus. This ends up leading to a change in the atomic number, which results in a new element. Back when we discussed atomic structure, we talked about how when you change the electrons, you change the charge. If you have a different number of neutrons, you have something called an isotope. Until now, we have told you that you are not allowed to change the protons because it changes the element's identity. This is exactly where that takes place. The concept of radioactivity was first discovered in 1896 by Henri Becquerel and Marie Curie. The element they were studying was uranium. They found out a little too late that uranium was radioactive and all the adverse health effects that it would have. So let's discuss why the different things are radioactive. In general, our neutrons hold the nucleus together to keep it stable. They act like glue because they're neutral. The nucleus contains both the protons and the neutrons, and the protons are positive and do not like to be together. So the neutrons kind of serve as a boundary or a barrier to prevent them from splitting apart. If you have too few or too many neutrons, an atom can become unstable. Eventually, when you get up to about element 83, no matter how many neutrons you put into the nucleus, that element is more likely to be radioactive than anything else because the nucleus is unstable. Elements with an atomic number greater than 83, which is bismuth, are radioactive. Let's discuss the different types of nuclear decay. The first type of decay is an alpha particle. It is composed of two protons and two neutrons. Okay. So because it is two protons and two neutrons, it is usually written as the symbol for helium. Okay. So what's taking place in a decay is something is breaking down. So what you're doing is we're starting with something we're going to call the parent isotope, and it's one thing, and it's turning into two. If it's alpha decay, one of the two pieces will be the alpha particle. Beta particles are a stream of electrons, and the beta symbol is this, 0, -1, E. Sometimes you'll also see it written like this, 0, -1, beta. And the same thing is taking place as with alpha. You start with one thing, and it breaks into two, one of which is your beta particle. The third type of nuclear decay that you are responsible for is gamma. Gamma is not a particle. Instead, it ends up being the release of extra energy, so it's a high energy ray. Its symbol is this. Now, as you can see in the diagram here, something that is high energy goes through gamma decay, okay, doesn't change its protons or neutrons, but it releases that energy. Let's discuss nuclear equations. These equations are chemical equations that show how atoms decay. The parent isotope always turns into what is called the daughter isotope, plus whatever the decay is. They are similar to chemical equations because they are still balanced, but they're balanced differently because we're producing something new. Okay. So we're going to make sure for these that the atomic number and the mass number on each side of the equation must be equal. And like I said, they're different from chemical equations because they're producing new elements. Let's do two sample problems. Before we do these, let's quickly review a chemical symbol. That X there represents any element on the periodic table. The top number is your mass number, and the bottom number is always the atomic number. We use the atomic number to figure out the element. Let's run through the alpha decay of radium-224. So that 224 that's provided may or may not match the table, but it's the mass number that we'd like you to use. So you look on your periodic table, you find radium, its element Ra, and it has an atomic number of 88. Then you'll put your arrow. This problem is asking specifically for alpha decay. The alpha particle is the 42He from the previous slide. Then, to find the missing piece, we're going to subtract. So you take your 224 minus 4, which is 220. And you take your 88 minus 2, which is 86. And then you look on your periodic table to find element 86, which happens to be Rn. Beta decay is done in the exact same way. We're going to start with our cobalt 60. The 60 again is the mass. Cobalt is element number 27. We're going to put our arrow. This time, because it says beta, we're going to do the 0, -1, E for our symbol, and then find our missing piece. We're going to take 60 minus 0, which is 60, and we're going to take 27 minus -1, which is 28, because when you subtract a negative, it becomes positive. Then we find element 28 on the periodic table, because this is again the atomic number, which is nickel. When you're asked to write these equations, you're going to do the same thing. The practice problems on the next slide tell you if they're asking for alpha decay or beta decay, and you would be asked potentially to write out the entire nuclear equation. One of the hardest things about these is finding the elements, because often they're elements we don't really talk about too often in class. At this time, please pause the video and try these practice problems. Here are the answers to the problems. One of the most common questions I usually receive with this in class is, what about the top number? Does it have to match? The answer is no. Your job is to look for that atomic number, so the bottom number of the two, and match it with the element that it goes with on the periodic table. The top number, the mass, does not have to match 100%. Let's move on. Let's talk about the radiation exposure and how you can protect yourself. Alpha particles can be blocked by 1 centimeter of air. Okay. They're quite large, so our skin protects us as well. Beta particles can be blocked by a very small amount of aluminum, such as aluminum foil, or a meter of water if they're in the water. Finally, gamma rays can be blocked by concrete and lead, just like X-rays. Okay. When it comes to harmfulness, based on what they can be blocked by, of course, gamma is the most harmful, then beta, and last but not least, alpha. Something that you may hear when you're discussing beta, alpha, and gamma particles are ionizing power and penetrating power. Okay. Ionizing power is based on particle charge. So the greater the charge, the greater its ionizing power. Alpha, in this case, is greater than beta, which is greater than gamma. Alpha has 2 protons, so it has a +2 charge. Beta is an electron, so it has a -1 charge. And gamma isn't a particle at all, so it's 0. Hence why this is the order they would go in, from greatest to least. Penetrating power, instead, is based on particle size. This is the exact opposite. So gamma has the greatest penetrating power, followed by beta, followed by alpha. And that's because gamma is energy, and then the alpha particle is larger than the beta particle. Let's discuss half-life and how to solve problems for it. Half-life is the time that it takes for 50% of a radioactive isotope to decay. So it goes from 100% to 50 to 25, so on and so forth. The half-life of each radioactive substance varies greatly. Carbon-14 is 5730 years, where sodium-24 is 15 hours, and uranium is over 700 million years. There are many ways to solve half-life problems. We will discuss them in our next video.